legacy builders, welcome back to lesson two of the trademark chapter of the IP for Business Blueprint course. I'm Jen McNeely with JWM Designs, and in this video lesson, I'm going to go a little bit deeper into the topic of trademarks and service marks, and I'm going to talk about what makes a protectable mark. I hope you followed my advice and gone ahead and downloaded that e-notebook for this course and are taking notes. If not, please go ahead and pause the video and click the link to the e-notebook in the resources area just so you can take notes and follow along with what's going on in this lesson. Also, make sure you check out the prior video lesson where I discuss trademarks and service marks, what they are, the differences between them, and what sort of marks can be trademarked, and the difference between a registered and an unregistered mark. Why now? As I mentioned in the prior lesson, everything associated with your business cannot be legally protected by a trademark or service mark. Understanding what makes a mark legally protectable can help you in deciding what to use as your company's mark and whether you should register your mark with your state or with the USPTO. Whether you plan to register your mark or not is extremely important that the mark you create or select for your business can be legally protected. As I mentioned in the last lesson, you do not need to register your mark in order to enforce your legal right to the exclusive use of that mark. Most states have unfair competition laws that allows owners of marks to get legal intervention if someone is misusing the owner's mark. But if you create a mark for your business that is confusingly similar to a mark that already exists or that is already registered, you will not have the legal right to enforce your ownership rights in the mark that you created. Likelihood of confusion. In your business, when creating or selecting a legally protected mark, your goal is to avoid the likelihood of confusion between your mark and the mark of another party. So what does the likelihood of confusion between marks actually mean when it comes to having a protectable mark? Two criteria must be met in order for there to be a likelihood of confusion. They are similarity of the mark and related goods and/or services. So what makes a mark similar? If two marks have a similar sound when spoken, look similar in appearance, share the same meaning or translation, or create the same general impression in a customer's mind, the marks will be considered confusingly similar. It is not necessary for the marks to be identical for there to be a likelihood of confusion. Let me give you some examples of how marks can be considered similar. Sound. Marks that may be spelled differently but share a phonetic pronunciation can be considered similar. For example, let's say your mark is Be Defined, B-E-D-E-F-I-N-E-D. And another mark is Be Defined, B-E-E-D-E-E-F-I-N-E-D. Those would be considered confusingly similar. Appearance. Marks may appear similar to one another, even if their fonts or text groupings are slightly different from one another. For example, Dope Brand can be in one font and then Dope Brand in a different style font, or McDonald's and McDowell's. If you've ever seen the movie Coming to America, you know what I'm talking about. Meaning and translation. If a mark shares the same meaning or can be translated from another language to mean the same thing, those would be considered similar. For example, let's say you have one company that's Southern Entrepreneur in English and another company, Empresario del Sur, in Spanish. Those would be confusingly similar. General impression. Even if the marks look, sound, or appear different, they can still be considered similar to each other depending on the overall impression that they leave. An example of leaving a similar general impression would be McDonald's, which most of you know as a fast food restaurant, and McSweet, which is a seller of pickled gourmet vegetables. This is actually a case in which McSweet was told that they could not use that name because McDonald's has so many things that they've already registered as trademarks with the Mc in front of it. So the next thing you've got to look at is how do you know if the goods or services are related? Relatedness is determined by the commercial relationship between the goods and services provided by the owners of the mark. Relatedness of goods and services does not have to mean the goods or the services are identical. For example, with the McDonald's and the McSweet case, McDonald's sells burgers and fries and so many other fast food things, whereas McSweet only sold pickled vegetables. But pickles come on McDonald's sandwiches, and so that is why McSweet was not allowed to trademark that name. Another example would be, let's say our dope brand sells t-shirts and hoodies, and the other dope brand sells hats and shoes. Those goods are all within the realm of apparel, and it is likely that consumers could mistakenly assume that the items purchased from one store actually came from another. I've linked a copy of the real-world example of a trademark case between McDonald's and McSweet LLC for you to check out in your free time. It will give you a good idea about how marks are analyzed for the likelihood of confusion. Now that you understand what makes a mark likely to be confused with another mark, here's what you can do to make sure the mark you select or create for your business is unique and protectable. The best and easiest type of mark to protect is one that can be described as fanciful or arbitrary marks. Because of the inherent distinctiveness, those marks make it harder for potential infringers to use a mark. A fanciful mark is a mark that has no known meaning and is typically an invented word or phrase. An example of a fanciful mark is Exxon or Kodak. The arbitrary mark is a word or image that exists but have no connection to the meaning. An example of an arbitrary mark would be Apple for personal computers or Peter Pan for peanut butter. A step down for fanciful and arbitrary marks are suggestive marks. Suggestive marks don't describe the product or service, but merely suggest or hints at the nature of the product or service. An example of a suggestive mark is Airbus for airplanes or Netflix for streaming services. A weaker mark would be a mark that is descriptive, and they are much harder to protect. Descriptive marks are words or designs that describe goods or services and generally are not protectable because they lack distinctiveness. An example of a descriptive mark would be warm and smooth hot chocolate or travel guy for a travel agent. I should note here that a descriptive mark can be made stronger if over time the mark can achieve a secondary meaning. This can take years to achieve, but once consumers begin to identify the mark as a source of a particular product or service, the mark has become protectable. A good example of this would be Best Buy or Sharp Televisions. I should mention that if you are considering using your surname, those are treated as descriptive marks. Surnames are not given protective status as a trademark until they achieve a secondary meaning through use over a long period of time in advertising. An example of this would be McDonald's or Hilton or the Kardashians. The least and most unlikely to be protectable is a generic mark. Generic marks are words or phrases that are so widely used and common that no manufacturer, no service provider could ever be given the exclusive right to use those words or phrases that generically identify a product. An example of an unprotectable word would be social media or shoes or accounting firm. How do I create or select a strong mark for my business? There is no quick answer to this question because there are several variables to consider. Remember, the purpose of a trademark or service mark is to allow consumers to identify the source of the goods or services. Factors such as the likelihood the mark will be easily remembered, pronounced, or spelled correctly are important when you're selecting or creating a mark for your brand. If you plan to market your goods or services outside of the US using the same mark, you also have to consider whether the mark will have a different meaning when translated into a foreign language. And because trademark protection only covers a mark for use in a particular class of goods or services, you've got to do your research on your particular industry. To help you get started, I've created a download that will aid you in selecting a mark for your business. A link to that is listed below in the resources area for this lesson. Why does knowing what makes a mark protectable even matter? For starters, if you plan to ever register your trademark with your state or the United States Patent and Trademark Office, you need to know what part of your brand is legally protectable. Registering a mark is inherently expensive and time-consuming, and it would be a big waste of your time and resources if your application gets denied because your mark is not protectable. Another reason is that your brand says everything about you and your company. Why wouldn't you want to take the necessary steps to protect it? Let's recap. In this video lesson, we talked about what makes a mark protectable, the factors that can cause the likelihood of confusion between marks, and what you can do to create or select a protectable mark for your brand. In the next video lesson, I will talk about the basic steps for registering your trademark and how to protect your mark, whether it's registered or not. Your action steps for this lesson is to download and complete the JWM Trademark Brainstorming Worksheet, which is in the resources area for this lesson. This will help you as you review your branding or as you create your brand. Also, I recommend that you take a quick look over at the McDonald's versus McSweet's trademark case to get a better idea of what goes into the likelihood of confusion analysis. All links to these resources are in the resources area for this lesson. If you've got any questions, please feel free to go ahead and send me a quick message and I'll make sure you have those. I hope you found this lesson to be helpful. I am super pumped to share this course with you. Please post your questions or comments in the video comments area below. You can also post questions and comments to our private Facebook group for this course. Remember, you can find me on Facebook, Instagram, and LinkedIn, and my handles for all of those sites are listed in the course resources area as well as in your e-notebook. Well, guys, that is it for this lesson. Until I see you in the next lesson, keep building.